So my goal for this is to share what works for me for lighting. And as photographers, we can't practice our craft without light. And frankly, I don't care what kind of light it is. It could be these wonderful lights, it could be available light, it could be a reflector. Light is light. But my tool of choice happens to be flash, speed lights. It works great for me. It listens, it stays put when I want it to. I love reflectors, but whenever I've had an assistant, they start looking at their watch and their cell phone, and the light goes everywhere. So speed lights work. And like I said, it doesn't matter what you use as long as you learn to see light and understand light and then the way you can shape and control it. And that's what we're gonna do here. We're gonna go through some images, some examples that I have, and then we're gonna do a live shoot. And I'm gonna show with you my approach to finding your color and exposure and then adding in an artificial light. We're gonna be using flash and then how I shape that. So the cameras today are just outstanding and amazing with all the features that they've built into them for us. You know, I remember the old school days. I'm old school, I've been doing this quite a while. My background is a photojournalist and we shot film. So I remember going out in the morning, your camera bag is filled with film. You'd have black and white film, color transparency film, color negative film, medium format film. So you were constantly changing. And then shooting sports, you start panicking when you get around frame 21, 22. Like, if there's a big play, do I change the roll now? Do I wait to the end? Right? So all those problems have gone away. We can virtually shoot unlimited with the size of memory cards today, and the cameras have built-in color meters and built-in exposure meters. And I'm gonna go through this in detail. And what that is just your histogram. So, you know, I don't wanna repeat myself from the last time I was here, so a lot of the basic foundation things I'm gonna kinda glean over really quickly. If you're interested in more of that information, please go back and look at the other video that we did for B&H, and it's got a lot of foundational stuff. I want this to carry forward for everybody and to do a little bit more of intermediate in advance. But the one basic thing I always try and drive home is get it right in camera and use the histogram, right? The histogram is something more than a stock chart. It actually gives us the value of color and it gives us the value of exposure. So let me go through a few images and I'll pull up the histogram and we'll talk about them. And then I'll show you how I find this in a live situation. And live view is just a really amazing tool for that. So we photograph big events, big ballroom weddings, high-end events. We don't have the luxury of doing outdoor, beautiful California light weather. So I have to go into these large venues that many times are lit by candlelight, low light, very dim. And while the cameras today can shoot at amazingly high ISOs and shoot cleanly, it doesn't mean the quality of light is good. So my wife Dawn and I, we're partners in this. I'm the photographer, she's the graphic designer, and she takes over and finishes the images after capture. We strive to capture anybody we photograph, literally, pun intended, in their best light. You know, great moments, great composition, and light. So while we can make good photographs in this environment, and they've really improved the lighting in the event space, if I'm looking at you, sir, you are totally backlit. You know, in order to expose for your face, and I'm an available light photographer, well, I could come in and do it, but your hair is gonna be completely blown out, and the highlight on your nose is just gonna disappear. It's just gonna blow out in order for me to see any detail in your eyes. Or we could ask you to turn around, and it's beautifully lit because the light is this way. So instead of always falling victim to the light that I'm presented with, I've decided to go on this journey of light. And I want to share that light with you. So lighting has allowed us to expand our brand, to charge more money because people don't light. Oftentimes I'm at a wedding or an event and someone will have a 5D Mark III, a Nikon D4. They'll have competitive cameras because everybody loves cameras these days, but they don't light, right? So that's another thing that separates us, you could say, from the competition and everybody else. So let me go through some of the things we do to do that and some of the tools I use. So if you want to find out any information about us for photographers, it's at davisworkshops.com. I've got a couple books. I'm really proud of the books. I'm very proud of our downloadable class, and that's at mzed.com, nz.com, What the Flash. It'll take you on this journey, show you all the settings, all the light modifiers, all the metadata. Speedlights. Speedlights are my tool of choice. And the reason being is I'm basically a location photographer. Everything I do is on location, whether it's down the block, down the road, or across the world. I was just in Japan 10 days ago on a shoot. I can take 5 speedlights, my cameras, and a few lenses, all with my rolling think tank bag, and never have to worry. Now, I do like big lights. I do like strobes, but I couldn't take 5 Profoto B1s with me on board. I'd rather have more lights. I've said this before, and I'll say it again. I'd rather have more lights than more light. So I'd rather have 5 speed lights versus 1 500 watt second head. Again, it allows me to do more. You know, we'll eventually do a 5 light setup here. And when I'm photographing in our large venues, I light the entire space with a technique that I've created called the triangle of light. So I could use 3 speed lights, the power of the ISO. And because we have radio capability with communicating from our master or our speed light transmitter to our off-camera speed lights in individual groups, both Canon and Nikon now do this. Nikon just released their radio-controlled speed lights. It's kind of limitless to what we could do. So if you need to, you could have up to 15, 16 different speed lights out there, all within 5 different groups, and mix and match those modes. So you could have one in TTL, one in manual mode, turn one on, turn one off, adjust their flash output to whatever you think it should be. TTL is amazing. I shoot roughly 90% of everything I do in TTL, which is through the lens metering. Right? It just works for me. It's quick. Now, if I'm doing a static portrait in a background or family and group portraits, then most often I will go to manual mode. And the reason being is the way TTL operates is it emits a pre-flash. The camera tells a speed light to emit a pre-flash. It calculates the proper exposure. The light comes back through the lens, and then the camera communicates to the speed light more or less light. It's basically the way TTL works. So if you have changing tonalities, if I put a white dress and a bride in front of a black backdrop, depending on how I frame it, it could blow out the dress. If I get a lot of the black background and a little bit of white in it, well, it's going to try and even out that exposure, and it'll give me too much light. Same thing as if we put someone in a dark suit, dark shirts in front of a black background, it may want to overexpose it. Say, wow, that's really dark. I'm going to give you more light. For that very reason, the subjects aren't moving. My lights aren't moving. I'm generally not moving my distance to the subjects. So I will go to manual mode, lock it down. And then people can go through. Oftentimes, our family portrait sessions for weddings end up being 2 hours long. So we want to lock everything down for consistency. TTL works great the rest of the day for me when things are on the fly. My favorite light modifiers from Westcott happen to be this perfect pair. And I call this a perfect pair because we have a shoot-through umbrella and then a medium softbox with a grid. There isn't much that I can't do with those 2 light modifiers. They give me lots of versatility and lots of options, which we're going to go through in our shooting demo. The shoot-through umbrella is great. It's probably the most forgiving and easiest to use light modifier because it's very diffused light. I hate using the term softbox because it's essentially a direct light source, and the light from a softbox characteristically is harder, more direction than an umbrella. An umbrella is actually softer, more diffused light. So I like to think in terms of diffusion or specularity and direct lighting. The grid within it allows you to confine the light and control how much it spreads out. So if I wanted to photograph somebody in front of this backdrop and not pollute it with light, I would add the grid because it would keep the light very linear and focused on my subject. So as we're going through this, if something comes into your mind instead of waiting too long, because I'm going to move kind of quickly, raise your hand, let me know, all right? And I'm going to actually share with you what these light modifiers do during the shooting demo. So this is a rapid box. Again, all these products I choose because A, the quality light is great, and B, they travel really well. I don't have an assistant, so I can set all this stuff up myself really quickly. It folds down, travels well. This could be a main light, a side light, a rim light, whatever you want it to be, right? I use a lot for details and portraits, and I'm gonna get to those examples. But I love the ability to also, again, have a grid on it so that we can actually control where that light is going instead of just sending it out there everywhere. This happens to be the medium 26-inch rapid box. It's like an Octobank. So again, yes, if you're interested in furthering your journey of light in your education, you have the What the Flash course, and it could be downloaded from mzed.com, mzed.com. All right, so now let's get into some actual events. So I'm gonna share with you one event to start. So we're just gonna take a wedding and go through its entire life. Now, my background's in photojournalism. The lighting I'm gonna share with you is lighting. It's lighting for people, it's lighting for product. Light is light. So it's not wedding photography lighting, it's not portrait lighting, it's whatever the case may be, because if you can light and shoot a wedding well, you pretty much could do everything, because you're gonna be a portrait photographer, you're gonna be a commercial photographer to get the details, you're gonna be, I hate to use the term photojournalist, but you're gonna capture those meaningful moments when they happen, right, as a fly on the wall. Photojournalism is not black and white with a tilted horizon. It means capturing a moment that has emotion in it. All right. So this particular wedding, we'll go through their engagement session first, and I'll go through them quickly, and I'll show you the metadata and everything else and how things were lit. And then I will show you their wedding day, and then ultimately how those pictures get used in the book design. So we do engagement sessions, do portrait sessions, family sessions, corporate work, everything. But now I don't leave home with less than 5 Speedlites. And I'll always have my perfect pair in the bag, nice small light stands that could fold up and travel well. So in this instance, this couple, her family owns a bakery. And it's been in their family for 3 generations. So as soon as she told me that, and her dad was sitting there and he's getting all emotional about the bakery and talking about it, I said, well, we should start your engagement session at the bakery. And dad's like, yeah, you know, he loves it. It's family tradition. The daughter doesn't want to take over the family business. She has her own career, but she's worked in the bakery since she was a kid. So this is her fiance. And so when you go into the bakery, it's all overhead fluorescence. It's dark, a lot of stainless steel, different environments. So if I'm an available light photographer, I'm gonna go in there, I'm gonna push the ISO up to probably 1600, somewhere in that range. I'm gonna have to put the fluorescent white balance preset on and then cross my fingers and hope she looks up toward the light so she doesn't get raccoon eyes. Or you can light it. You can bring in a couple speed lights. This is actually just 2 lights, one off camera on the halo, the shoot through umbrella, and then one bare flash as a backlight. You know, and I say this time and time again, I am a backlightaholic, right? I like images that pop off the scene. So that backlight acts as a separation light. So if you watch movies, watch some of the better TV shows, they light. Meaning everything just isn't a bunch of soft boxes and just overly soft, flat light. They actually have highlights and shadows. Highlights and shadows are what give your pictures depth and dimension. So this is just one speed light behind. I had it positioned directly behind him. See this rack that's back there? I used a 175F Bogan Justin clamp, boom, clamped it right to the rack. And notice that there is no, remember I said what kind of light was in this environment? Fluorescence. So what color light do fluorescents give off normally?
Green.
Green, right? There is not a green cast in the stainless steel or in her white shirt, is there? The reason there isn't is because I filtered my speed lights to match the environment. So I use a plus green filter over my speed lights and chose the fluorescent white balance preset. You gotta remember to do both. Then I could use all the light in the environment available to me without worrying about a color shift. So if I pull up this information and we look at the histogram that's here, it's pretty spot on. So what I'm looking for in a histogram is with the RGB, the red, green, and blue levels, and this is the same histogram you'll see on the back of your camera, is that they're near equal in length, left to right. In this particular instance, you could obviously, you're in a big bakery, it's a kitchen, all overhead fluorescents. They weren't daylight fluorescents because you could just tell. They were green, they give off a green cast. So knowing that, if I just use my speed lights and then kind of slow down the shutter speed or raise the ISO enough so some of the ambient light comes in, we would start getting a green cast in the background in the stainless steel and on her shirt. So for example, it could look like this, right? Starts to get green. So see the green channel in the histogram starts going to the right. That means we have a lot of it. So knowing this, I put a plus green filter. It's something you could buy in a sheet right here. Plus green filter, cut it to fit to your speed light or strobe, put it over the flash head. So now you're taking a daylight white balance strobe or speed light and converting it to fluorescent. And you have to remember to set the white balance preset on your camera to fluorescent as well. If you don't, auto white balance won't filter out all that green and your images will still end up looking like a green cast.
What's the distance and angle of your shoot through?
The distance from the couple here is about 15 feet and it's off on camera left. So you can see where the shadows fall. I generally light for the girl. I want to make sure that she's going to look good, not too many hard shadows on her face, because women don't want their nose to look too big by accentuating it with a large shadow. So if we go back, and if you watch the histogram, if the image was too magenta, see how it shifts? Magenta pulls the green in, but then the magenta starts going out to the side. Conversely, if we were shooting in a tungsten environment, the image could be too warm. See the red channel starting to creep out on the right? You would see that on the back of your camera. So anytime a value starts going to the right, it just means you have a lot of it. And then you have to determine how do you want to handle that. Auto white balance does a pretty good job. The reason I don't use it is for frame to frame consistency. So if I'm shooting in this environment, we'll pull up all the images that are in the bakery, in the back part of the bakery. They're consistent color-wise. Now my composition is changing, meaning I'm shooting with two cameras, a 70 to 200, and a 16 to 35. So as I go wide, I'm taking in more of the environment, more of the fluorescent lighting that's reflecting off the stainless steel. That means the white balance is going to be adjusted for that. As I come in tighter, maybe on their hands or for a portrait, yet again, the white balance will be different. So you'll have these subtle variations across your take. I'd rather lock it all in. And then it's also even easier to batch correct in Lightroom versus using auto white balance, because even though you're picking it up and laying it down, it still reads some of those parameters from the information of auto white, and as you recompose and change within your frame, your white balance is shifting. Follow me? So that's why I just like to lock things down. So I want less work on the back end. The goal is to do the shoot and move forward and not get caught up with 8 hours of post-processing. Right? So you could see the nice separation light, the little bit of subtle rim on her arm. If there wasn't any lighting there, the scene would start to go black in the background and appear very, very flat. So we get this compliment all the time when we meet with couples or clients or people. They're like, I don't know what it is. Your pictures are so vibrant. They almost look 3D. And what they're saying is there's depth. And the reason there's depth is because I look at a scene and I'm like a dog with a bone when I see light. How can I improve upon this? I'll take what's there, and then I'll add the sparkle. I'm not trying to overlight it, right? This was all their fun idea. Write out their initials. So then they went out in front, And again, if I did not light it, you would not have that light in her eyes. Same two lights, boom, brought it out front. And the umbrella is so soft and diffused versus using a soft box, it's not as directional. I didn't want that directional quality because she told me I'm self-conscious about my nose. So if she says that, I don't want to make it look any bigger or have her worrying about a shadow going down her cheek. So I listen, you know, and of course, she loves all the photos. I went a little bit too over the top with the backlight here, but you know, you're shooting quickly, you're moving quickly. I'm not trying to turn their engagement session into an overly produced photo shoot. But I do like the way these turned out, you know, shooting through the bread. Now here we changed up, because these were tungsten. The lights more in forward part of the store were the recessed can lights. Those are tungsten, so they're orange. So I then took the plus green filters off and put full correct to orange gels over the speed light. And again, remember to change the white balance preset on your camera to the tungsten white balance preset. And again, we can look at the histogram. Yep, everything looks good. We do have warmth from all the bread and the shelving, so we don't want to overcorrect the red. If you go too far, your people turn into Smurfs. See how they turn blue? But we're pulling the red back and getting it balanced, but that's overcorrecting. So you kind of have to get it in the ballpark and then judge it. It's just like cooking. What flavor do you like? Some people like their images cooler. I like mine warmer. I like people to look warm and alive. You know, that's just my thing. All right, so then they wanted to go outside. It was a blistering cold winter day. They wanted to play with their puppy dog and they wanted to be outside. So great, we'll go outside. She's wearing this big hood with the fur, really cute and everything, but how are we gonna get light in there? Okay? You could shoot some available light and it's gonna be great, which I do. I'll shoot available light and then I will also light it. So here, you're outside, the wind is blowing, it's flash for cash. I don't have an assistant, so there's no big light modifiers because they would sail with the wind. You know, I wasn't gonna carry sandbags out here. You could tell it was snowing pretty good. And so I was using bare flash. But here's where I took my technique called the triangle of light outside. They're gonna be playing with their dog. This is a beach, that is a frozen lake, in this fenced in area. So I set three lights up that pointing in the direction to where they're gonna be in different groups, and I can control that flash output completely. So you can see we have a side light coming in and we have a front light coming in, right? Still getting light on her eyes, in her face. So this really is helpful. And dogs, oh my God, they absorb light. Are you kidding me? So if I expose for all the black detail in here within the dog and his coat, in Lee's coat, we would lose all the pretty little snowflakes. So what I'm doing is I'm bringing the contrast range or the exposure value down enough to where we could have the ambient light and then fill it in with flash.
Do you use Stofens on your 600s?
Do I use Stofens on the 600s? At times I do.
Do you use any of the colored ones?
I don't use any of the colored Stofens. I just cut my gels and put it on. I'll buy a sheet of CTO and plus green and then some others for theatrical use for fun. Yeah, these are all using the triangle of light. Now, it's made my wife's job a lot easier. You know, because probably I may not have lit this as much as we would see here. And I did shoot a lot. These are their actual client photos. And I did shoot a lot without flash because I want to cover my bases. I just don't become reliant on one technique. And for every one of those, my wife's like, boy, I really got to work hard to open up her face in the hood. And then I got to open up the fur on the dog because I was still trying to retain detail with snowflakes. So by holding the exposure down, now all of a sudden we're losing detail in the shadows. So, you know, whoever is doing your editing, my wife happens to do it all, she would rather work on this image. Our clients appreciate it more, so therefore it's better all the way around. Right? And beautiful catch lights in the dog's eyes, so it just works. And then when they were walking on the path, same thing. I just set up two lights, had them walk toward me, just add a little bit of fill. Right? Same thing. Then continuing inside lighting to create effects and drama. Again, the separation light, really, this is outside the Chicago Bears locker room underneath the stadium, so it's really dark. And that separation light just kind of pops them off of the background. And then the same umbrella in the foreground for that nice, soft kiss of light. Here I can pop it open really quick. And these are really light stands, the nano stands. So you can pick them up and fold them. And these light modifiers collapse and travel really easy. Easy thing to do. So his family's been a season ticket holder, so it was really important to get their shoot here. And then, yes, the shoot continues into the night, right? Now here we're going to be pushing the ISO. So this is 1,000 ISO, 30th of a second, aperture 4.5, and you betcha, I'm filtering because the city lights are tungsten. I want to get that sky to start dropping bluer. So if I'm shooting, actually this is shot in Kelvin, I can actually play with the color temperature. I'm not fully at tungsten, I'm around 4,000 degrees Kelvin. So the light on them is a little bit warmer because they have full CTO gels on it, and yet the sky is not overly artificial blue. Now, within this light sculpture, these are LEDs. They're daylight. So we're starting to get a lot of mixed lighting going on, so that's why I didn't go to full tungsten value. If I dropped down to 32, those lights would be really blue because my speed lights have a correct orange tungsten light source. The city lights and the sky would be very blue. The city lights would be fine, but the sky would be blue. But you can see my histogram looks great. Yes, sir?
Did you use backlighting on this one?
Of course.
where did you put the speed light?
So these little stands are great. It's a bare flash behind them.
Did they, the couple hid those?
Yeah, they're a gobo. They're in between me and them. So what's nice is the speed light is lightweight, so it sits on here, and then we could collapse these legs very, very narrow and just lower it down.
So they
and it's
hid,
the.
They hid, though.
Mm-hmm. It's back in here.
Okay.
And it's about mid height.
Uh huh. Cool. I got you.
Coming forward, because you could see right where the flash goes.
Gotcha. Okay.
Right? Gotcha. You could dissect pretty much any image you see if you reverse engineer it, so to speak, or if you look at the catch lights in people's eyes. The backlight?
Yes.
It's directly at them. It's slightly upwards because Lee was so much taller than Samantha.
Yeah.
And if you aim it too low, we wouldn't have any rim light on his head. So you gotta balance that, you know. It looks funny if someone's head disappears into darkness and the other person is rimlit.
Yeah. How far behind them was that place?
It was about 10 feet behind him. You know, but that ebbs and flows on what I'm shooting. I try and get it as far enough back so I don't have to Photoshop out the legs. You know, oftentimes I do make that mistake, but thank God I have my wife, Dawn, who can Photoshop them out. Yes?
So when you're doing a setup like that, how long does it take you to, like, position everything?
Okay. Well, because I live this, and I'm Michael Jordan of speed lights, it takes me that long. I walk in, I see the scene, I know exactly what I'm going to do.
Right.
And that also comes from being a photojournalist, because you're always on deadline, and someone says, here, you got 15 minutes or 5 minutes, whatever, to produce an image. You assess the scene really quick, and you go to something that's not too complicated. My lighting techniques are not complicated. I don't believe in, especially on a wedding day, we're not there photographing models. We're not there to turn their day into a photo shoot. Right? We're there to make great photos quickly. And no matter what I'm doing now, I kind of operate under that mode so we can make good photos quickly. And the reason I'm pushing the ISO up is because as the ambient light is dropping, I still want to capture that. And I'm hand-holding this. I don't often work with a tripod because it just gets in the way for me. I'm a little bit high energy that way. So I'm going to raise the ISO. So the holy trinity of exposure is ISO, shutter speed, and aperture. Okay? ISO determines how sensitive the camera is to light, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Shutter speed affects the ambient light, since I'm using flash. Aperture is the output, the energy I'm asking this flash to give me. So if I wanted to photograph this at f/16, Speedlites might not be the right tool of choice. But because I'm shooting 3.5, rarely am I above aperture 5.6. So I don't need much in terms of power. I could get away with these small Speedlites and really use them. There is no noise in that file. I mean, the cameras today, 1250 is kind of low. I mean, it really is. You know, what we had to do with film, are you kidding me? This is amazing, right? I mean, these are tight.
Bob, are you still using the umbrella?
No, this is two straight up bare flashes.
Oh. With the gel on.
With the gel, yeah. And I'll let you know when I'm going to use the umbrella. Sometimes there's too much wind outside and I don't have an assistant or want to carry a bunch of sandbags. So even here you would say, okay, why do we need to light it? Well, because my images pop and most other photographers who would be shooting here don't, right? They'd shoot at available light. So this is, again, two lights. But here's a little bit of a trick. I'm thinking, okay, sunlight setting over the stadium. What color is sunlight when it sunsets? It's warm. So let's put a half-cut CTO on that, stick it way up in the next balcony, just out of camera. We're going to actually take the flash head and manually zoom it in. So with our speed lights, you have the ability to modify them manually. And what I mean by that is you have a Fresnel lens here on the front of your speed light. The flash tube moves back and forth within it. So wide angle, it's a floodlight. As you zoom it forward, it becomes a narrower beam of light, such as a spotlight. So we could go from 20 all the way up to 200, and you could see that flash tube moving in there. So from flood to spot. So for this one, I zoom the flash head in the back around 105, a little bit more direct, and then just one off camera on the front. Again, making sure that I don't make the shadow of her nose look too big. I think her nose is cute, but you know, it's not what I think, it's what she thinks. All right, so that's their engagement session. Wedding day. Now again, I'm sharing with you wedding pictures, but lighting and control of light and light modifiers and lighting techniques are good for anything. So again, just looking through overall consistency, color, exposure, those sets of things, right? Now, when we get into doing, you know, the big family portraits like this, of course, gonna use big or larger light modifiers. Now, yes, I can use two halos, or I can use two medium soft boxes, but then you really have to watch for the shadows between the people. So this is with a really large halo. Now, because I'm going to be shooting, this was about 2 hours of family portraits, all the different combinations, I still use the rapid boxes for two side lights, rimming them to pop them off the background. But then I used this guy, two of them in the front. It's the OTB. Now, I can use this with speed lights, which I have, and I'll show you that today. And I'll just use two of these, one off camera left and one off camera right. But the key is how you place them. Most people tend to point the center right at the center person. If we do that, you're going to increase the amount of shadow in between people. So if I'm doing this group, all of you here, and I had to photograph it, I would take this, point it towards you, the last person, and then I would have this exact same light modifier over here pointed towards the last person on that end. That way, the light is going to wrap around everybody, be really, as you can see, soft and beautiful. No on-camera flash at all.
Where are those
backlights? They're off to the side. At them. It's a rim light. So it's in these rapid boxes with the grid, so we're not throwing too much light flaring at the lens. So there's one outside the field of view, see on her, pointing down toward the back of the people. Same thing on the other side. You could actually start to see a light pattern on the floor. And I'm using the rapid boxes, again, just to control where that light is going, instead of a bare flash just willy-nilly pointing back toward me. Because things are happening quickly when you're doing these kind of portraits. I don't have to worry about the flash flaring into my lens.
You're actually feathering those two large...
Yes, exactly.
You're feathering.
You're feathering them so that they'll overlap, right, and you're not going to get that cross shadow down the middle.
Right.
Again, there is no reason to do uber creative, tricky lighting in a scenario like this. You know, you want to photograph them, clean, beautiful images, the ability to see everybody. Why does this keep going up on me? Highlights in everybody's eyes, beautiful light. Now, because I was doing 2 hours of these formal type photographs, I'm using strobes, right? Why not? Yes, I have done these with speed lights. You just have to shoot slower. You have to pace yourself. Even with a Bolt battery, which does improve, which I use the Bolt batteries on these, it does improve recycle time tremendously, but it's still just a speed light. And when I'm doing these type of things for 2 hours on end, I'll go in earlier in the day, set up my lights with the OTB halos, boom, I'm ready to go. I'll bring my other lights up to the bridal suite, get the prep, and then I'll already have my lights in for the reception.
What f-stop are you at on those portraits?
On the portraits, good question, probably around 5. 6.3. Yep. Yep. As the groups got bigger.
And you're posing them?
I am. Yeah. Definitely.
When you go to do...
It's like herding cats. Hello.
When you go to do a shoot like that, do you go in advance and check out the space?
Do I walk through ahead of time? I do. If time permits, I do. Definitely. I mean, a lot of our destination events... If I could get in early enough to do it, I will. Just because it brings me to a certain calm that I'm not feeling as frantic the day of. And I've eyeballed it, and I've been doing this long enough that I just need to eyeball it. I don't need to actually set up the lights and do a test shot. I'll let the room speak to me and the subject speak to me as to what light modifiers and what I'm going to do. You know, for things while the bride is getting ready, you know, now this is completely different, you know. So makeup artists love window light, big window. She's getting ready in front of the window. That's great for this. Everything else would fall off really dark. So I like to light, like there's lots of light spilling in from different windows and reflecting off different surfaces. So that's the window light is the main light and 2 lights in the back of the hotel suite pointing towards me, right? Bare flashes, and because you have the freedom now, they're in different groups with the radio controls to turn them on and off and up and down at will. If your particular light in the back is giving you too much light, you can turn it down. In this instant, I turned it up. I turned it up on purpose because there was lots of distracting elements going on over there, and I didn't want you to see them, right? So by putting some brightness in that area, kind of softening it with flare, right? So lighting could be used for anything. Yet the light that's still skimming on her from this side is from my other flash, but you could see I brought that flash output down much lower. And that's the beauty that you have at your fingertips today with different groups and radio controls. Even if you have older speed lights that don't have radio controls built in, you had the line of sight capability, and now there are endless amount of radio triggers that will allow them to communicate for TTL. You know, so in here, using 100 millimeter macro, 80th of a second, 3.5. But, you know, I mean, I love putting detail and highlights in the eyes. For me, that brings the image to life.
There were 3 lights in our eyes right there.
There is. There's makeup lights, there's the window, and then my lights. Come on. So the makeup lady had like a living room thingy for with 3 reading lamps on it. Those aren't my highlights. But we don't have a shift. Why? Because I filtered my lights to match the dominant light source, tungsten, right? So again, this nice highlight on the back of her hair. If I didn't have another light in the back corner of that room, this image would just fall off flat. Old movies, things of that nature. Of course, you could shoot towards your light when they spray, hairspray. Every bride loves that. Here you could see we're getting that direct flash look because my lights are in the corner of the room and they just said, oh, let's just do a photo here. Like, sure, I'm not gonna all of a sudden change everything and they're direct, so shot it. You can say, yeah, we could have turned the flash heads up, but in the heat of the moment, I'd rather have everybody lit than worry about the direct shadows on the wall. I wouldn't necessarily make this a bridal portrait of her, but for a moment like this, I'd rather get the moment. And you know, when brides are getting ready, putting the earrings in, step in, take charge. Otherwise it always looks like, I can't get that earring in. You know, they make a scrunchy face, right? So you wanna say, oh, look out the window and think about, you know, Lee walking down the aisle and the first time he said, I love you, and a bridesmaid goes, oh, that was sweet. And boom, you get this beautiful moment as she's just kind of touching the earring, ever so nice. It looks like it happened. But when it's really going on, it's like chaos. And you have to slow it down for a second. I'd rather slow things down, get an image that I know they're gonna love, and do something to elicit a real emotion and capture that, than just get the chaos. And my wife is the one who's really, Dawn has said, look, I know your background's photojournalism and you're getting these amazing moments, but it looks like that, you know, like she's trying to wrench this in, or there's like, you have to remind the bridesmaids in the background, hey, this is a great day, this is fun, looking at the moment, so you gotta let people know, because what would this look like if she had a real sourpuss, right? So, you're responsible for the entire frame. I really love the Rapid Box. And I'm not trying to be a commercial for Westcott. I use their products and they invited me to be a part of their team because I love the quality of light. Remember, I've been doing this since there was 283s, 285s, and you'd have long sync cords and optical slaves, and you'd have to cobble something together to get a light modifier on it. And now that they make these things specifically for the tools that I use, I'm giddy. Are you kidding? I could shape this. This is without the grid, right? So the light spreads out a little bit more, but it's still just one light source. I wanted that directionality. Awesome. And same lighting, just change the lens, right? Light comes from a direction. I try and keep it off access from the lens as much as possible because shadows are just as important. Gives us that dimension, the depth. A few photos of the dress before she got in it. Now here I'm lighting to create a little bit of drama. You know, this one, what I'll do oftentimes if I want to create a harder light source is I do love the Rapid Box a lot, get it off to the side and up high, and you could even zoom the flash head. So normally you'd want to have it around 24 or 35 in here to optimize the entire interior, but there's nothing wrong with saying to zoom it to 105. You're actually creating a more direct, harder light source to create those shadows. Right? So it's two. One was direct and hard, and then the other was diffused for a slight fill. So the shadows weren't too deep. So after a while, you start to see in terms of light. And then you start to see like, oh, this light modifier would work great for that. Instead of not practicing and just doing it willy-nilly, you have to shoot with purpose. You have to practice. All great artists, they practice with their paints and their pencils, and athletes constantly practice and visualize. Well, we as visual artists need to do the same. We need to know our tools, we need to know our light modifiers, we need to know what everything does and how we can control it and not fall into a routine. So I may use the same tools over and over, but I use them in different environments in different ways all the time. Details, 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 details. So I love using two rapid boxes, and I'll cross light them to the side, again, to create depth and dimension, one in the front and one from behind. Every hotel room has a glass tabletop, right? So you can start, here's where that commercial hat walks in, and you put it on, now you're a commercial photographer or a studio product photographer, right? It's not just bounce flash on camera, getting the image. You know, this one, it wasn't such a nice day outside, and the window wasn't beaming with light, so I had to help it out. So I took two speed lights behind the curtains, one left, one right, bounced them into the window frame, and it made it look like more sunlight was coming through. And then one rapid box was the main light, right off here, camera left, filling it in. So it looks really natural. Here you go, right? It's not a studio shot. It's in the hotel suite. And because I practice this and I live it, I could pull this off in 5 minutes. You know, I know what I'm going to do. I know I could turn a beige wall with wallpaper completely white, as long as it's not deep gray or anything, or dark black. Pull the desk maybe 3 feet from the wall and just flood that light, flood the wall with light, washing it out, and then using one of these rapid boxes in the foreground, just for the details. I'm gonna jump over here really quick to another wedding. This is one of my favorites. We just did this wedding and I love that image, but here, oh, well, let me start with that. So this image here, you can see where the reason I'm going this way is her favorite color is pink. She liked pink. She had a lot of pink uplighting, she had pink flowers, she had pink details. I knew this ahead of time. So when I did her details, I used two rapid boxes for my main lights and then one bare flash with a pink gel against the wall. So again, for her, it's triggering emotion. It's pulling in her details. She goes, where did you photograph this? There was no pink lights up in the hotel suite. I'm like, yeah, I know. But people appreciate when you listen. If you're a portrait photographer, listen. If you're an editorial photographer, listen. And then if you could add those elements that people tell you into the images, they become emotionally connected to them, right? It's just a glass tabletop. Make sure you clean it, otherwise you're gonna be spotting out all the little dust spots on the glass that you don't see until you light it. So the details, I put as much effort into lighting them as I do to lighting the couple. So our collections have unlimited hours. Our average wedding is 14, 16 hours long. We designed it that way with purpose because neither one of us, Dawn or I, are good salespeople, and I always felt icky going back and saying, ooh, it's 11 o'clock, I've been here 8 hours, you know, you're just getting into your fun dancing and stuff. Do you wanna go the overtime? Do you wanna pay it? And I'm not good at that, so we just decided to go unlimited hours on our collections. And that way I could arrive at 10 in the morning and, you know, talk to our brides ahead of time and say, have all your personal details there, and I'll spend an hour doing their personal details so I don't feel rushed. And then when you get in the environment, you know, light things up, right? That's not available light. That's available light plus my lighting. Here's a big room. This room is 2 stories tall. It's about 200 feet deep, 100 foot wide. And I light that entire space with 3 speed lights. Now again, not with big light modifiers, for a couple reasons. One, a small flash firing off in the corner is an instantaneous pop of light that most people will not notice. I start pumping a lot of light in a big light modifier like this, it becomes obvious and distracting. And it also takes a ton of energy to light a large space with a large light modifier. So in this instance, there isn't one. So here's where I set up my triangle of light. And here's one of the speed lights off over here. So I just had one going on at this time, but then there's one over here. In this space, there's a speed light. And then I'm in the technical loft on the 2nd floor, shooting down, and there is a speed light up there. all in independent groups. So then I could choose to use the lights, give it the kiss of light, and blend it with the light that's in the environment. All tungsten light, color correcting for the dominant light source, so the speed lights match. Here you could see one of my speed lights going off. But it just adds nice depth and dimension to our details. First look, more portraits, you know, and then try and do something a little bit fun. Ketubah signing, I mean, we like these. But if I didn't light it, this veil would start to disappear into the background. There's a nice separation light coming in from the side. Now these are the processional, recessional, all with the triangle of light. This isn't crazy high ISO. This is only 1250 ISO, 1/25th of a second, because I don't want any motion from the ambient light, at 3.5 or 4. At that aperture range and that ISO, I can shoot one frame per second with the Bolt batteries and have good flash output, good recycle time, versus just having the four AA batteries within the speed light. So definitely when I'm pushing the lights this way, I use off-camera flash with battery packs. But it gives, look at the way the hoopah that they had made out of ribbons and orchids illuminates with two cross lights on it, one from each corner, right? It just brings your eye right to it. Lighting is a way to pre-touch your image instead of retouching it. And I'm guiding the viewer as to here's where I want you to look through light and shadow. Here you can start to see the flare of the two front lights. The third light is up above. You can see the shadows going on here. When you start pointing these things out, it becomes obvious to where the lights are and how it was lit. And a triangle of light is really taking the level of our work to a whole new place and with respect in our market. Dancing, horror, shooting with a long lens, short lens. But are you kidding? You wouldn't get moments like that if you're just trying to do it with one bounce flash or no flash at all, available light.
Are you on a ladder?
Am I on a ladder? No, I'm standing on a chair further back. What lens was this? I don't even remember. Yeah, 70 to 200. Same settings, 1250, 1/100th of a second shutter speed, 3.5. Here you can see the triangle of lights going off. Now in this instance, the on-camera flash is active. Now the reason being is if I've got two lights in the corner of the room here and one in the back, and I'm photographing off in this area with you guys, what's going to happen?
You'll be in the shadow.
Yeah, well, I'll be in a shadow because the light's coming from behind me, cast a shadow on you. Of all kinds of cross-shadowing going on. So now I lower the flash output from the remote lights to make the on-camera flash more of the main light. So we fill all that in. And this is shooting with a 14 millimeter, I believe, right in the mosh pit with all the action going on. A 15. So it's really tight. I want you as the viewer to be right there with them, where you can almost hear the music. But I also want to have beautiful light on them. Look at that rim light on the back of her head, right? It's layers of light. It's not just using my light. It's also using the ambient light. And it's not trying to overpower it. So I'm not trying to shoot for dark black backgrounds and overly lit scenes. I'm trying to blend it all and give it a kiss of light. All right, so now I'll just go through this one with you. This is the actual book design. Yes, sir?
Do you always use JPEG?
Do I always use JPEG? Good question. I shoot RAW and JPEG. So I have two media cards in my 1DX. RAW is what we primarily use. JPEG is an in-camera backup. I want to have two different cards with two different formats. I could shoot raw, but this is what works for me. Because if I shoot raw, I mean, we do shoot quite a few high-end celebrities. We did Mark Carmelo Anthony's wedding here for you guys in New York. I've done Eddie Murphy's, done a lot of events for Oprah. When you do events like that, the images get published in, let's say, People magazine. So I need to deliver those images to an editor come first thing Sunday morning. I just don't want to be up all night processing raw files, because they do need to be processed. Yeah. So I'm comfortable, because of what I'm going to share with you next in live view, is how to find your color and exposure and get that correct in camera with my JPEG files. So I'll hand them the JPEG files with client approval, and they're content to go from there. It does save a lot of time when you're on deadline. So this is their actual, Sammy and Lee's actual book design. And this is all what my beautiful wife and partner, Dawn, does. So she takes the images throughout the day. And this is something that I have to think about, too, when I'm shooting. How are these images going to relate to one another? Is the lighting going to look cohesive for this spread? We can't have one image overly dramatic with too many deep shadows, and then everything else kind of looking bright and airy. So you kind of have to think about that story as you're going through the day, and the lighting has to reflect in the way these images relate to one another on the page. See here, we're a little bit more dramatic lighting for their first look, but it's all unified. Big bridal party, right? So still with the two OTB halos, two rapid boxes, and then I said, what the hell? Yes, I am a backlightaholic. Let's throw one behind him. Because I just liked the light coming through. My wife said, yeah, you could have eliminated that one. But I kind of like it. That was for me. So we debate on that one.
So three behind.
There's one behind, two rim, so rims are off to the side, which I'll set these up and you'll see exactly what I mean. And two large front light sources so that I don't worry too much about shadows when we're doing this at a rapid pace, right? I can't always watch all these people to see, are you leaning forward enough? Are you slouching back enough? So the larger light modifier helps soften those shadows. Versus if you tried to do that with a small light modifier like this, are you kidding? They'd almost all have to be right in front pointed at them so that there wasn't overlapping shadows. I've made that mistake, believe me. Yes?
How long does it take you to get all those people to like not have their hands out in the way of everything, like to kind of pose them all?
Sure. So when we're doing these type of formal photos, we tell people, our couples, when you're putting together your formal portrait list, think of this. It takes on average 5 minutes per grouping. So that means of you and your dad, of you and your husband and your mom and dad. Each one of those are 5 minutes. So while those may go faster, when it gets to this one and it takes 12 minutes, that time cushion is built in. So it gives them a realistic frame of reference to wrap their mind around the number that they give you on the list. So that ebbs and flows. So like I said, this probably took 10, 12 minutes to get everybody together, look at me, pay attention, you know, take a few frames, check them before you let them go, then I'll definitely chimp. Because once you let them go, to pull them all back again would be really difficult.
Do you tell them where to sit?
I do. Yeah. Sure, because they don't know. They don't know, you know. And it got to be so big, the group, that we had to incorporate chairs because otherwise it keeps getting bigger and longer and wider.
This may seem like a silly question, but...
No, no silly question.
It's very easy to have somebody with their eyes closed. I mean...
It's very easy.
So, I mean...
You shoot a lot of frames.
Okay.
You do.
To be able to see that in the viewfinder is very difficult.
You're right. You shoot a lot of frames, too. I mean, I wouldn't take just three frames of this and say, done, I got it. No. I shot it on two cameras. No. Probably got 10, 15 frames of this.
20 to 30
frames. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. And then to hold their attention, you got to be kind of like jumping on, yo, over here, look at me, I'm here. You know, really, it's like put the feather on a string and wave it around. But these are some of the most meaningful photos for people.
Sure.
People and family and friends are coming together in a celebration that doesn't happen very often. And while I hear from a lot of photographers that shoot weddings, like, oh, I hate the formals, right? You could kind of pretty much screw up everything else, but not these, and you'll be forgiven. You blow these, forget it, the whole shoot is a wash. Right? I've been doing weddings for a long time.
I would never think to include that chandelier.
Well, it's kind of necessary, because in order to get the group,
no,
the format, and I knew if we shot, I did shoot some tighter, but if I shot wider, we could have actually run this spread across both pages. And then we would have lost the chandelier. So it's not all super tight. As you can see, it's a lot of portraits. Their first look on the aisle, meaning they get to see the room before all the guests arrive because they've been dreaming about this day, making all these decisions. I want to put them in there and let them soak it up and see it and capture those moments ahead of time. So we want to tell their story. And it, we're very proactive in this, meaning as soon as we get the images and we get them their gallery in about 5 weeks, all their images are up, Dawn is very proactive. She immediately designs the book without any input. Because that way there, we get them off the start. They're going to be overwhelmed looking at anywhere from 1,000 to 1,500 images. And by being proactive and we design it and lay it out, we give them 2 rounds of unlimited changes. So they could completely change the book design if they desire. Usually the only place they change images is in those formal photos, usually. All right. So how about a little bit of regular, everyday portraits, right? And then we're going to get into some demo shooting. So this was for the Salvation Army. They wanted to do, for their magazine, a feature story on some of their successful clients, I guess you'd call them. And so I had to be very quick and nimble, in and out, and get these things done. Yes, I could have done them all available light, but why not light them and do it with character? So we used 2 rapid boxes that were strip lights and 1 rapid box 26-inch Octobank. So in this case, this light is going to be the main. This light's the fill, and that's also a fill. So if you look, oh, you could kind of begin to see the yellow gel on the back of my flash. So yes, I'm still getting some of the environmental light, which is tungsten. Didn't bring the X-Drop backdrop with me, but I did find in their cafeteria a white wall, which you could turn into high key. Same principle as the shoes, right? Then each person was able to pick a space that spoke to them where they wanted their portrait taken. So lit them all accordingly. So now let me share with you the actual images.
So if you were doing corporate, you would do it all with Speedlites?
I would, and I have, and I do. Because I've got a total of 8 Speedlites. I can set up, if I'm just using 2 lights, I could set up 4 different scenes and get them done in 10 minutes. Boom, next, boom, next, boom, next, and offer, if it's the corporation or the magazine, more variety than if I'm like, oh, I got this big backdrop and 2 big lights and that's all I could shoot, and we'd have to strike and move somewhere else. And in corporate, they don't have time for that. You know, so the more you could get done quickly, the more variety you can have. So here's the images that they ended up using. So nice character, you could see the slight fill. Here, I took the diffusion out of the grid, out of the rapid box, and just used the grid to create a light pattern on the wall to cast shadows. Again, just something a little bit interesting other than a cross in a hallway. But I just didn't give him that. So I also give him what I would call the safe shot as well. Looks very natural. Looks like the light coming in from the windows down this hallway. But you saw the behind the scenes. There's 3 lights there, right? two side lights with the strip lights, and the main light was the Octobank. This image is actually three lights as well, and I wanted it to feel like this great light coming in from the loading dock area. When, you know, if we pop back over to the behind the scenes, and here you could actually see my backlight. I wanted to pop them off the background. And then there's two rapid boxes just inside the garage door facing them, side lighting them, even light. No grids, no diffusion. But just feels natural. So if we did that.
Halo round is on. Obviously you want to keep that.
I did, yeah. So here's his setup. So you can see we had the two strip lights and one bare light so that we could create this. So I pretty much use speed lights for anything and everything.
When you're using a speed light to for the backlight like that, are you typically zooming it in?
Am I zooming in the flash head? Yes, definitely.
The backlight?
Definitely, and it all depends on the effect I want to have.
So you're concentrating the light more on them, so it's coming out.
For sure. You know, and then get creative. You know, if how many people in here actually do weddings? Anybody? No? Great. So when you're at the reception, usually once the formalities are done, the cake cutting, the first dance, all that stuff, toasts, it's just endless dancing, right? So why not get a little bit creative? The groom was boasting that he had these cigars, couldn't smoke them at the hotel. I said, well, we could kind of create this feeling. The one groomsman gave him the bottle of scotch. So I'm thinking, you know, smoky environment, rat pack kind of a feel. So here I decided to go hard light, right? So I'm using two rapid boxes with the grids, boom, and then one light in the background as a bear. And I went in the kitchen, like I need something to make mist. And I saw a cleaning spray bottle. So I dumped out the cleaner, filled it with water, had our second photographer, I'm like, okay, you ready? Psh! Shoot. Took about four frames to get this, right? Why not? But I had a vision first, had something in my mind's eye that I was thinking, you know? Again, directionality, it's just blending the available light and one of these. So where do you think this light was? Well, it's coming from behind, right about here. And then I'm asking her to look towards it. And then because shutter speed is equal to ambient light, I just adjust my shutter speed to allow more ambient light to come in to blend the two light sources. So for me, it's all about light. Like I said, I don't care if it's a speed light, a reflector, or what kind of light. I'm going to use all the light available to me. That's just straight up beautiful natural light. There you go. Now in the church, this is one of those churches that you don't have enough time to set up your light modifiers. So I use my triangle of light for the processional and recessional in the church. I just turned all three of those. I had one light in the balcony and two on either side of the aisle. They were all facing forward, right? Because there was literally, they recessed and all came back up the front. We had 10 minutes to do their immediate family. And yeah, there is more shadows than I normally like, but it's better than using one bounce flash, and we were under time constraints. Now this is just the halo. So the halo, let me dig that bad boy out, is much smaller than this. So this is probably the easiest, most versatile, and more often than not, the first light modifier I reach for, because it's very diffused, right? And versatile, meaning the flash head could face forward for rapid recycle time, more specularity, or because this is all silver material on the interior, if I close it and face the speed light backwards, now it's reflecting off the silver for even more diffusion and softer light towards the front. So here, and we're going to do this in the live shoot, you can see if I shoot this way, very soft shadows, but we still have character. We still have directionality, but the shadows are soft. Where if this was a soft box, that shadow would fall off very quickly, be much harsher, right? She wouldn't appreciate that, right? So these two portraits were done exactly with one halo. And I really like this one. One halo, right? Quality of light. One halo in the room. So cool. All right. Questions while I evolve this into the live shoot? Yes, sir.
How far out does your speed light, you can give command to your speed light?
How far away? What's the distance and range for controlling? Excuse me, I'm a little dry. So it's a factor of two things. Because the Canon and also the Nikon system operate at 2.4 gigahertz, which is the same frequency as Wi-Fi. Now there's so much traffic at 2.4 gigahertz that you have to check your environment. So in here in B&H, with all the radio frequency traffic that's going on, the range would be diminished. What that range would be could be 50 feet. It's going to be diminished. And what they say normal range is 100 feet. Now, I've used them up to 200 feet in a clean environment, meaning no competing radio frequency. So at least, where's my camera? I have not actually touched or seen the Nikon system, so I don't know. But with the Canon system, this works the same way on the Speedlite or the Speedlite transmitter. This is the SDE3. First thing I do into any environment that I'm in, that I'm going to be photographing, that I'm unfamiliar with, is I activate the device. And then I go to the scan feature. So it's actually scanning the environment to try and decide what is the strongest channel. So we have 15 different channels plus automatic with the Canon system. So as you can see, not too many channels available, right? We've got channel 15, 9, a little bit of 4, a little bit of 1. Normally, those are all up. Now, I happen to know, because I scanned this environment, that this corner has got a lot of RF. So if I come over here, and if I scan in the middle of the room, well, now we're going to get stronger signal strength. So there are times when I'm in an environment where this is completely suppressed, so I have to carry a backup communication system, which I do. So 15 stronger here, right? But there's a ton of RF in this store, all at 2.4.
What's your backup system?
My backup system, good question. So my backup system is still radio poppers. So I happen to use radio popper JR2s, and I'm just comfortable with them because I've known radio poppers since they've gone into business. What they do is they allow me to still use my Canon speed lights in 4 different groups remotely, only in manual mode, but I could put them in groups 1, 2, 3, 4, and I could change their flash output from the transmitter, okay? I don't care if I'm working in ETTL or manual. I could work in either or, as long as I could have my lights off camera and communicate with them. So I do carry those as a backup. They're at 900 megahertz. There's nothing at 900 megahertz anymore. Everything wants to be at 2.4. So that's my backup plan. There's many different ones you could choose.
Pre-reception hold shoot, do you go and scan each corner?
I do. I walk through the room and I scan it. And it's really important to scan it after the band is set up. So our weddings are big ballroom, big bands, 20, 25-piece orchestras. They set up their own wireless network on the stage with a router on each side because their mics are wireless. They're using iPads to send the set list out so they could change it and flow. The instruments are wireless, so that's a lot of information going on in there. So I have to check those out to make sure. And I'll choose oftentimes manually, like in here, I chose channel 15 because that's the strongest channel in this environment. You have the auto channel capability where it will send out a signal and scan, and the receiving speed lights will be waiting and sending out information and scanning. But what happens when there's a lot of radio traffic in the auto mode is sometimes they don't all sync up simultaneously. So one will fire, one may not, and you get more misfires. So I'd rather, again, like I do with my images, lock it in for consistency, scan it, set the channel, be done.
And you also set everything to a unique ID.
You can. You have a 4-digit personal identification number. So if channel 15 is the strongest, we could all be shooting on channel 15 in here without any crosstalk. Yes?
Is it possible that it can work with the remote? Say if you move to try to the main, you're right over here, the flash unit, and then you're, or rather the Wi-Fi sender, and then you want to have your flash in the corners, but it's not, there's some other conflicting Wi-Fi going on, and it wouldn't work?
It's possible.
So it would
definitely
work on that corner, but not on that one.
That's why I scan, you scan the room. So you'd actually see, if I scan here, and I scan there, and I scan there, I would choose the strongest channel that Canon offers with 2.4.
It would cover all the 3 points.
Correct. Okay. One will average out to be the strongest. Now you might just think, well, let's just put it in auto and it'll figure it out. And as I shared before, in my experience, it doesn't always figure it out because they're both sending information out and they're both trying to get on the same channel when there's a lot of radio frequency interference. It doesn't happen often, but it does happen enough to me that I need a backup. I've often asked Canon, hey, can you build like a signal booster or go to 5 gigahertz instead of 2.4? Something, because of the environments that I'm in. So I showed you that one. And while I get the camera set up, I'll show you, this is from a recent shoot where we set up a studio on location. So anywhere could be a studio. And I'm not going to let location dictate that I can't get good light.
Would you prefer paper over muslin backgrounds?
I do like paper for white, for high key. I don't have to worry about wrinkles or anything in the background. So white, seamless paper, super white, works great.
Over a muslin.
A muslin painted? No, I'd take a muslin painted, but a muslin white?
Yeah.
Well, then, you know, in a lot of instances with a muslin white, If there's any kind of light coming in from the background, it might pass through the material. I've just ran into more challenges with it. And then you see the wrinkles a little bit more. The paper just kind of hangs flat. All right, so may you come up and join us? What's your name again?
Tatiana.
Tatiana, thank you for joining us.
Sure.
Right, so you don't have to just stand and be bored. Okay. You could have a seat right there. Relax for a second. I'm gonna get this going. So I'm actually gonna attempt to see how CamRanger will do in this high traffic 2.4 gigahertz environment. All right. So I'm gonna share with you what I do. All right. Is it working? Yep, it's working. Okay. So, just kind of relax, enjoy. Want a piece of candy? Need a cup of coffee? Need anything? You good? All right. So this is the way I go about using Live View. Can I ask you to move over this way a little bit? So please forgive me because this is not going to be flattering, okay? Think of it as a test. All right. So I just got the camera in focus. I'm going to sneak up over here. And we'll open up Live View. So this is what I would do on the back of my camera. I don't even take test photographs anymore. So we're in Live View. We could see our histogram. The camera is in aperture priority mode, ISO 640. So it's picking everything. We're in auto white balance, and it's doing a decent job. As I shared before, if I come in tighter, or if I come in here, there we go. We could start to see my blue coming up. We start changing and affecting the white balance. So if I'm doing a bunch of portraits, I want that all to be locked down. I don't want to, on the back end, be worried about these little inconsistencies and getting frustrated trying to color correct them all. Okay, so let's just play with white balance at first. So I use daylight as my baseline, and the reason being is because auto white tries to filter out any color shifts, if it's tungsten, if it's fluorescent, anything like that. So I popped on the daylight white balance preset, and we say, wow, it's daylight. These are daylight balanced lights. They have very nice lights in here now, right? Her shirt is white. We look at the histogram. In fact, they're a little bit cool daylight. Okay, nice. So what if they were tungsten? So if I choose the tungsten white balance preset, now, look what happened to my histogram. It's blue. It's telling me there's a lot of blue light in this environment, okay? So I put the camera in tungsten white balance preset, meaning it thinks it's needing to see warm lights. But because these are daylight balanced, it made them bluer. So remember what I said when I was shooting the city right at twilight, just, you know, after sunset, I filtered my lights for the city lights, which are mostly tungsten. So the sky was beginning to get bluer, bluer. It's exactly what's happening here. Anything that's daylight is going to render blue. But you could see that shift in the color histogram. So what if it was fluorescent? Well, we got more green. You could start seeing the green come out to the right. Now, CamRanger shows far more colors than the back of your camera. Your camera only shows red, green, and blue. So she has now a bit of a magenta cast on her because when we use the white balance preset, it's trying to filter out all the green by adding a magenta tint. All right, so if I go to Kelvin, we can lock it down or just put it in daylight white balance preset. It's the only thing I can't change on CamRanger is the actual Kelvin value. So if I remember correctly, it's around 6,000 degrees Kelvin. So now look at my blacks. They're beginning to be gray because I've introduced too much warmth. So we're giving them a yellow cast. The black tones are getting a yellow cast. Her shirt looks dingy, not white, white, right? Follow me? So that's how I know where to start my color. So, okay, if I wanted to go with this, if we're gonna shoot in here, we're gonna start off at daylight. All right, so daylight is our established white balance. So then if we go to manual mode and we pick an ISO, well, let's leave it at 640 for a second. In 640, here where you could see if I was gonna leave the aperture, somebody pick an aperture. What should we do a portrait of Tatiana, correct? Mm-hmm. Yes, sorry. My brain is a little scrambled. Okay. What aperture would you like her photographed at?
6.3.
6.3? Okay. So if we choose an aperture of 6.3, that's gonna be the output we're gonna ask our flash to deliver. At 640, we're still getting some ambient light. You could see the catchlights on her face. You could see our histogram is way towards the shadow side, toward the left. So it's grossly underexposed. So let's take a frame, so we're actually looking at an image instead of live view. Okay. Ah, you were right. Failed to see. Oh, wait. Maybe because I moved it. I did. I got to put it in the right spot. That's what it might fail to save. Desktop, event space, open. All right, one more time. So we'll capture a frame. There we go. No problem. Saving it. Good deal. So we pick that image. Stopping live view. Here's the image and the histogram. Remember, it's still slightly blue. See the blue channel creeping a little bit to the right? We can't see it a lot because it's so underexposed. Okay, that's at daylight. So daylight is roughly what degrees? Anybody know Kelvin temperature daylight is? What? 56? Yeah, 56. So that's what I would say is I want to lock this in. I don't want to worry about it being too blue. I want her flesh tone to be nice and warm. So I'm going to come over here to my Kelvin setting. And I'm going to start off at 57. And let's see what that does. Because I don't want it slightly blue. Okay. My next thing is I'm going to share with you is here's where you could see shutter speed affecting the ambient light. Okay. Oh, look, it's slightly warm at 57, right? It might go 56, but see the red came out? I like my images a little warm. So if I slow down the shutter speed to somewhere around the 20th, now you're going to see that ambient light becoming more prevalent. Now we have more ambient light coming in. Okay, so that's where I'm trying to show you how shutter speed is equal to ambient light, aperture is the output that we're going to ask from our flash, ISO is how sensitive the camera is to light, thereby how hard the speed light has to work. Okay, with me so far? All right, so we're going to raise the shutter speed up because I want zero influence from the ambient light. So let's go to 200. Set the shutter speed. All right, we still have some, so we're gonna lower the ISO from 640. Let's go to 200, just arbitrary. So virtually no ambient light. All right, so again, Tatiana, I apologize. This is not gonna be pretty light. Mm-hmm. We're gonna use on-camera direct flash, and then we're gonna get it off camera right away. So you can actually see how we can evolve this light, right? So Tatiana, do you have a favorite side?
This side.
Okay, so you want to turn your legs slightly this way? Good. And I'm doing that because white shirt, black background, looking square at me, she looks wider and larger than she is. Turn her a little bit sideways, have her chin come toward me over her shoulder. Boom, and all of a sudden, no, you look good. She looks more dimensional in the frame and not as wide. So I like to put my focus mark right on the subject's eyes, lock it on, and we'll take an image, and it'll come up. Oh, Bob, can you move that other rapid box, please? Yep, just so we could see the screen. All right, so thoughts? I want class participation here.
Okay, it's way too bright on her face.
Way too bright on her face, you think? I don't think it's too bright. I think it's still blue. I think it only looks blue bright because of the monitor. But you look at this one, there's detail in her shirt. Yes, she's shiny. That's from direct flash, right? But it's not blown out, okay? So I personally, me, don't want a blue cast in her shirt, right? And we saw this earlier. Now we've cut out the ambient light altogether. So 57. All right, let's try this one. So we're in TTL, direct flash. The zoom on the flash head is matching the focal length of the lens. All right, so better. Her flesh tone is warmer. Everything looks good. If I was gonna shoot and shoot with direct flash, I would say, okay, I could live with that. But let's get the flash off camera. And I'm gonna use a Speedlite transmitter. And we're gonna start with the flash. Do you have a question?
No.
Oh, thought you were gonna raise your hand. All right. So my Speedlite transmitter's on. And I have this green indicator light, which lets me know it has successful communication between master device and remote device. So we're gonna start off with this at 20 millimeters. And I'm just gonna pop it right about here. And I like the shadow to fall a little bit naturally, so down instead of up her nose. Okay, so on camera, we got it off. Now, Tatiana, if you could just look right toward the lens, thank you, good. Turn your shoulders a little bit away, good. Nice smile, here we go, this should be getting better, good. All right, so now, just getting the flash off camera, let me fill the screen, should help. And it did, it's helping, but it's still direct hard light. Now remember when I said the way ETTL works? It's reading a lot of her white shirt, thereby underexposing a lot of the dark. Right? Because the flash emits a pre-flash, reflects off her white shirt, goes through the lens. So I know this already. If I'm going to live in TTL, what to do is I will go flash exposure compensation, and I will bring it up. So I bring it up plus 2/3 to start. That's usually where I begin all of my TTL exposures. And we go from there. All right. So now we have a better exposure on Tatiana. I'm just gonna move this a little closer. Good. All right, so Bob, would you zoom that flash head to 200, please? Now, so what we've done is we started off in 24.
If she was wearing the color, it wouldn't be doing that.
Possibly, depending on the pattern or the color of the reflectance, because this is reflectance. All right, so now what we did is we zoomed the flash head right in, good. And remember, we left the flash at plus 2/3 flash exposure compensation. When you zoom the flash head in, it's actually magnifying the light, thereby making it appear a little bit more intense.
And yet you are trying to...
Well, I know it's not white, but I didn't want it having a blue cast.
Okay.
So that's why I'm leaning toward the warmer tone. So you could see the spotlight effect, see the harder shadow on her. All we did was zoom the flash head. That's all we did to modify it. So let's turn that, we'll just take that guy over. By the way, that's A. So we'll just set it over by the computer. And let's bring out... Or no, you want, let's keep that one in. Sorry, that's all rigged up. And let's throw on the halo. We'll bring that guy back over.
Okay.
So at first we're gonna keep the flash direct, facing forward. And I'm gonna set the flash head because I wanna fill up the entire front of the diffusion area. So I'm gonna go 24. And I'm gonna have the flash facing forward so it doesn't have to work too hard. See what that looks like. Because she's a little bit shiny, I bet it will look better if I bounce the flash off the back, but we'll see. Right? All right, Bob, can we put this right about there? So now we have much more diffusion. Top, bottom, all the way around. So I can have the light a little bit off to the side, and we're not gonna produce harsh shadows. Everything's gonna stay the same. Again, I put the focus mark right on her eye. Good. And my focus limiter on, there we go. Awesome. So you can see all the parameters, manual, 200th of a second, 6.3. So the light has been softened on her. The actual shadow wraps around and it's softer. We're photographing her on a black background on purpose because I want to make this image low key. So we need something here to balance out the shadow side. Or, you know, we could bring the light in closer, but the closer you bring the light, the greater that fog off is, the closer it is to the subject. So now let's just bring in this rapid box. And we're going to have the grid on it. And this is in group D. And I'm going to control the spread on it. This is actually going to be a rim light, so let's see. Should be good. So Bob, if you can go over by D, I might have to have you tweak it a little bit in a minute. So I have group A, and I'm going to go to my D, and I'm immediately going to lower it to -3. Because I don't need much light coming from that side. I just want to fill it in. Don't want to overpower it.
All groups are still TTL, correct?
All groups are still TTL. A little more smile. You could do, there it is. Give me a beautiful smile. Lean a little toward me. There you go. Nice. No, there you go. That turned it on, right? Good. So adding the second light is like having a reflector. If you don't have a second light, you could have a reflector and have it come in close. Boom. Now we're getting somewhere, right? Got a nice highlight on the side of her face. We can actually, if we wanted to, add in the third light. So Bob, let's raise that up a little bit and then down so we can actually separate her from the background. And this is C, that's D. And then this one is going to match that one exactly. And the reason for the grid is so that we keep the light confined right here and not spread out everywhere. Follow me? You guys awake?
Yeah.
All right. So I'm going to take D and be -2. C, -2. So they're the same. A is in the halo. We're all good. Give me that magic again. Beautiful smile. Where is it? You could do it. That's it. Nice. So just before I take the photograph, I'm accustomed to seeing it. There's an instantaneous pre-flash, which I can see. So I can read that because I've been doing this so long, and I know how the light is going to fall. You can hit the depth of field preview, and it will give us a modeling light, right? So now she's popping off the dark background, right? Very nice. So we do have warmth. See, the red is creeping out to the right. That's the way I kind of like it. So I am actually going to bring up the D light, just bring the light level up. C, I think, is fine. D just needs a little bit more flash output. Good. And now turn a little bit. There you go. That's good. That's good. Leave your shoulders where they were now, but turn your chin toward me a little more. Beautiful. That's great. Excellent. Very nice. So watch for the pre-flash. Did you see it? So if you're conscious of it, you could see that happening, right? And actually, this is a little bit still off to the side for me, but I asked her to turn her head towards us so that we soften the shadow side of her face from the previous frame. Either way, I mean, now they're both looking good, but we could decide, right? So the one thing I'm not liking is this flare right on the side of her nose. If you look forward again, please. Yeah, there you go. So that's this guy. And we're just going to feather it just to the side. Yeah, I think so. Good. And now I'm going to move this light a little bit over. Awesome. Make sure it's not in my frame. It's not. Sorry to place that right in front of you. Just beginning to get right in my frame. There we go. That's good. Nice. Wonderful. Still got a little bit of her nose on that one. There, that's much better, right? So now we could have a lot of fun with this. So you saw how this is softer on the shadows, correct? Yes? So now let's leave the two lights where they are, our rim lights, and let's change this from an umbrella, shoot-through umbrella, to a softbox. And you'll see the difference. And then I'll actually change the character of light. So again, the big plus with the Apollos and the Halos is you don't need a speed ring, travel well, pop it up, same versatility, flash forward, flash backward. So I'm gonna turn the flash head to shoot into the box for this one. Put it on the umbrella shaft. There we go. Now we also have an inner diffusion baffle for this as well. So if you really want to get soft with your light, or I shouldn't say soft, but more diffused, we have the inner and the outer. Okay, but I'm going to leave it a little bit specular at first. And we're going to get it in the same position roughly. So here's the inner diffusion. We have another diffusion panel, and then we could also put the grid. It's recessed, so it's going to give us more directionality. So we're going to have harsher shadows. So I think right about there to start. And if you look straight at me again, yep, just straight, good. Now watch what we're going to get for shadows. Very nice, thank you. Good. So where do you think that shadow is going to be on the side of her face? Right? Different characteristic, different look, different feel of light. Now for this one, I want to go a little bit more low key on camera, right? And I'm going to take the D light and drop it lower. There we go. So this is the power of TTL, and I really like that. Or just having the wireless capabilities. I don't have to walk over there. I don't have to change anything. I don't have to re-meter. I don't have to touch it. Some people like to work in all manual. Whatever works for you, it's all good.
You're using Canon lights, right? All our
Canon? All our Canon speed lights, yeah. I couldn't use Nikon speed lights on a Canon and have the same automatic features. Just in manual mode, you could. But yeah, I'm looking at that monitor. It's in the dark. I like that. That looks great, right? Gives it a little bit more character. So let's show you how we can diffuse the light a little bit more. Add in the outer diffusion baffle, and then we'll make kind of a character study image. And I think, Bob, in the lid of my think tank bag there, there's a packet of gels. Would you find the forest green, please? Okay. We're gonna leave the light the same, and we've just added, remember, it's really double diffused because the flash head is facing backwards. So we're enveloping the entire box, so there's less specularity as it would be facing forward. We have one inner diffusion baffle. Oh, yeah, just keep it up. Would you get the forest green one out in the back there? Because I'm gonna put a green gel on the background. All right, really nice, looking right toward me. There you go, great, beautiful. Good. So I already see that I've lost some flash output from A, because I can see that pre-flash. I do this so frequently. But that's also diffusing the light a bit as well, taking the shine down some. Actually, I'd ask for makeup and say, put a little bit of matte. But see, it is less specular than the previous one. Okay? Cool? Good? Got it?
Yeah.
Awesome. So, boom, 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 boom. Speed light, please. And I'm going to use this one. And from behind the curtain. So I thought green might look good on a black background. Could you come up to right about there, please? We'll have to rejigger our lights, but I think it'll be worth it. So I'm going to put a green, just a theatrical green gel. I just randomly chose it. It could be whatever color you want. And we're going to put this in group E. That you can't set automatically. And let's just start off at 35. And this is the triple threat, which I sometimes use to mount three speed lights together to act as one for more flash output when I'm trying to do high-speed sync outside and get really kind of creative. And let's see what that does. So group E.
Which way is that facing?
Toward the back, to put some green light behind her. Bob, can you take the D light and just feather it a little bit towards us? Yeah, that should do it. And let me make sure the E group is on. All right, and I know it's going to try and light up a black background, so I'm going to start off at -1 with the flash exposure. Cool. Ooh, too much green. But it's there, right? It's a great start. Everything else looks pretty cool. Bob, can we spread out those legs so that light stand may go lower, please? Cool, right? And that's at 50, right? Let's see what it does. Looking right toward me, beautiful, good. So I'm trying to create that vignette effect going upwards. But look at the histogram too. All of a sudden we've introduced a lot of green color value, right? Not bad. So I think it's a little bit too punchy, the green. So I could go all manual, but instead I'm gonna say, well, let's go to the E group. Let's drop it down to -2 1/3. And I'm gonna change the zoom on the flash head. So it's at 35. Let's make it 70. See what happens. So we're just trying to vignette the light.
Do you ever use that little plastic wide angle that flips out?
Rarely do I use the wide angle diffuser on the flash. Rarely at all. There we go. So now we've got four lights going. We've softened. We're getting that little bit of a painterly vignette in the background. So there's a lot of bread and butter in Facebook headshots, LinkedIn headshots, real estate people. So we could go high key, we could go low key. So let's do something really kind of cool in character. You said this is your favorite side?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna turn and face all the way that way. Good. Now, just want you to look straight toward that light. Good. Now we're just gonna use two light. Well, let's start off with just one, so you can actually see what we're doing. So I'm gonna turn off the B group, C group, D group, and E. So all we have is the front light in the softbox. Pretty cool. All right. Bob, can you slide? Oh, wait, I know what to do. So we don't need to see the controls anymore, right? You're comfortable with the histogram and stuff? We just need to see the pictures, yeah? We only really need to see the image. No, we'll leave the control strip up, okay. So, beautiful quality of light, wouldn't you agree? So now we're gonna bring the C light in. So that's completely cross lighting, right? I think so, why not? Maybe a little bit like this. Should it be up higher or down lower?
Same height as the key.
Yeah, I think you're right. Let's see. Very nice. So Tatiana, can you turn just slightly toward just your body? There you go, but then look straight into the light. There you go, really nice. Now I want you to think beautiful thoughts. It's a nice day outside. There you go, good. All right, I forgot to turn on my C light. C light is on, so I like the expression better. Oh, C light's down -2. That should work good. All right, wonderful. Here we go, C light's on, cool. So TTL is not something to be afraid of, right? I'm controlling it through exposure compensation, flash exposure compensation. Yes?
You said that's all +2/3, right? That's your baseline?
Baseline was all +2/3, and then I went into each group and adjusted them. So right now, the C light is -2. A is 0. But the global flash exposure comp is +2/3. So that's giving me the white and the detail that I like. So on the screen, Bob, on my laptop, is there a detail in her hair on the top? Or do we need more? It's hard to judge the TVs.
A little more?
Yeah. So all we got to do is go over to C, raise it up. And then we're going to put the green on. All right, Tatiana. There you go. Beautiful. Very nice. Cool. So there's a lot of flexibility and creativity that you could do. Nice. Now, if I add that background light in again, in group E, it's going to give us a lot more fill because it's adding light or depth into the dark background. High key is really easy. We could pop that off in a second and go all high key. We'll do that next, right? Nice. Wow, that looks really nice. Look at that. I like that. Now, Tatiana, just turn toward me just slightly. Good. Now, what do you think is going to happen if I take a photograph with her like this, with her looking at me? Yeah. It could be a little bit unflattering, right? Because it's going to extend the shadow of her nose beyond the crease in her cheek, which I generally like to keep that shadow right in the crease. It's a little bit more feminine, unless you're trying to do something, you know, character or moody, which it's pretty cool, right? Because her eye is still catching that light. What's that? Yeah, well, it could be. But I wouldn't just shoot this and give it to her and say, I'm done. I'd give her both looks. I'd give her something a little bit more flattering. I like to get the safe shot first and then evolve and have fun and play, right? So I could take this off. There we go. Can you open your front shoulder just slightly? There you go. Beautiful. And again, I don't focus and recompose. I put the focus mark right on her eye. Good. Just felt like doing that. All right. So Bob, let's go high key. Let's take the black off, please, off the background. While I grab a drink of water and that downloads. Pretty fun, right? That's pretty cool. Get this out of the way for a moment. Each one of these TVs are different that I look at. Oh yeah, that looks cool. There we go.
This light does not wash out the green?
No, it does not. This light does not wash out the green because of the grid. The grid is keeping the light linear.
Oh, it's keeping it away from that.
It's keeping it from polluting the background. That's why I love grids. Okay. If I didn't have the grid, you betcha these two lights would spill onto the black.
Right.
It wouldn't be black. And it would wash out this screen.
Right, you got it.
Definitely it would. Definitely. So now we're going to take our lights. We're going to remove the grids. Sorry. Tilt these guys back. And the reason now I'm going to remove the grids is we want this whole thing lit. Now, ideally, maybe you should bump out to there because I don't want the light spilling off of the background. That's good. Because this is white, it's going to be very bright and lighting her from the front. So this is D. And let's just spread these guys out to 20. I'm going to set the zoom to 20. Get as much width out of them as we can. We'll turn the E light off. And we'll see if I have them evenly spaced. Now I'm going to go manual on C. And I'm going to start it at a quarter power in D. And why would I want to go manual?
Because of the white on white.
You got it, the white on white. Yep. We want that to be white and not 18% gray. Because what could very well happen is they will become a dirty white. That's about right. So I'm going to turn off the A light so I could see exactly what the background lights are doing. I'm going to get those set first. Oh, I set that in mode. Yeah, it's off. Good, good, good. Excellent. Again, I focus right on her eye. Good. And we'll see what's going on there. Now, the way you know, look, that's pretty good, even lighting. Now, the way you know you have a proper exposure for your background is you have a nice, crisp, defined edge around her. That's great, right? But you could say, you know what, I want something a little bit more dreamy and ethereal. Okay, so we take and go from a quarter power, just go big or go home, we'll go to full, 1:1. No ambient, all our light. Now I'm pumping so much light off that white background, it's gonna wrap around and we start getting a milky edge and we're beginning to get spill over on Tatiana. Right, neither way is wrong. It's whatever style or look you are going for. So I'm gonna go back to that quarter power. All right, Bob, can you bring over the Apollo, please? And we'll make that the main light. That's our A light. And I'm gonna leave that one in TTL. And we're actually gonna, maybe where this chair is, Bob? Yeah, we'll move that chair. Thank you. Don't kill the talent. You might have to pull it back just a little bit. Let's see, that's good. Good, I'm sorry?
Are any of these setups better for people who are not 16 years old?
No, so that's why I shared with you the double diffusion in here. Yeah. So I actually came up with that inner diffusion baffle for this Apollo because I had to photograph Hillary Clinton at the Lincoln Center here, and I was there for 3 days with her, and the first test shot I took of her with just single diffusion, not so good. So I actually took my other diffusion sheet and stuffed it in there around it to get as much diffusion as possible because it was really showing the bags under her eyes to soften it, right? So yeah, it helps. And then if you start to slightly overexpose your main light, you will also wash out those fine lines in detail. Instead of most fashion photos, the main light is slightly hotter than everything else because it helps to wash out those imperfections. You don't want any shadows in the lines. There we go, good. Awesome, there we go. So we go from low key, adding in a little color to bam. What does Peter Hurley say? Shebang or shabooey or whatever, right? Right? He does. He's got the whole shtick. I wish I could do the shtick, right? There you go. There you go. Drop your chin just a little bit. There you go. Just raise your lower eyelid, right? There you go. We'll use the whole Peter Hurley thing. No, too much smile, too much smile. Give me something sneaky. Whoa. He's got the shtick. I don't have the shtick. I wish I could. But you could do headshots on location. You can use a white wall. I mean, I like the medium softbox for this because it gives us a defined shadow. It gives her face some character. So if I was using someone older, a little bit more character, if you want to jump up there, I would switch to the umbrella.
You want me to go up there?
If you want to. So we'll take one first with this setup.
Oh boy.
Excuse me.
We'll leave the lighting exactly the same, so you have a seat. Maybe a little high for you. So let me just get a couple of these stray hairs off, right?
Oh, yeah.
Devil's in the details. You don't want to have to be photoshopping that out. So you see it ahead of time, just fix it. Can I get the one here? No, no, your scarf was good. You just have one right there.
I'm shedding.
So take a second and look.
Yeah, one in the front, too. That's, yeah.
All right. Good deal. Very nice. Now, with glasses, too, most people have really good anti-reflective coating on their glasses now, where it used to be a real pain in the butt. What you do is you just have to have the light almost at a 45-degree angle and then drop their chin slightly so the light passes through instead of reflecting off of the glasses. And you could use the depth of field preview, squint your eyes. Yep, no reflection in her lenses. So, how about a little smile? I mean, so serious. Jeez. Good. So I didn't change any values at all. Manual, TTL on the front light, ISO, blah, 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 all the same. And yet we still have a nice image. But see the shadow side of her nose and the definition in her cheek and her little dimple? It's more pronounced because we have the softbox. So let me just do one last quick change here. I'll swap this. Ooh, that would be fun. Where's the big one? The light stand that I had the green gel on, Bob? Small space. Don't look behind the curtain. Nothing to see here. No, oh yeah. So I want to take that triple thread off. And I got a bigger light stand. Where did I leave it? Hold on. Now this is the importance of a light modifier. You're really gonna see this, you're gonna like this. Okay, right? Like Joe Pesci. All right. No, we don't need a green gel on it. I don't want her to be immersion. So, what'd you do? So I'm setting this to group A, setting the flash zoom to 24. May I have that speed light, Bob? Doing the exact same thing with this guy. A24. Because I want more wattage in the cottage. All right. One more. Yes, I do. That's why I don't leave home with less than 5 speed lights. And
do this for Hillary?
No way, I didn't have this one. Otherwise, I would have. Are you kidding? This would have made things easy. She wasn't very nice. I think she was having a crabby day. Okay. Everybody has an off day. I couldn't imagine walking in her shoes, what she has to go through. All right, let's get that big one out. The OTB. Yes. Now you're going to see a big difference, right? Can I just ask you for safety for a second? If you just pop over there. All right. Hope I don't bug you. Hold on. We're going big. Okay. So I'm running 3 speed lights just because this is a big light modifier. Outside the box halo. It could be horizontal, it could be vertical. It slices, it dices, it does it all. It's just a ginormous version of the regular halo. And I love this thing for the quality of the light.
Which one is this one?
What size is that?
Dave, you're still in here? Is Dave still in here?
Yeah.
What's the size on this thing? It's big.
You gotta wrap it up.
All right, this is the last one. That's why I was gonna close with the big one.
Dave,
What size is this?
Okay.
40 by 60.
Stay. All right. Wow, it takes up a lot of space. So for this last shot, can I ask you to just stand up over there for a second, please?
Sure.
Thank you. So we could get you back in the same spot. Take your chair. Small studio.
I got it for you.
Okay.
Okay. No problem.
Tight space, tight space. Thank you for your patience. Here we go. All right. Good deal. Good. And we'll have you come over so you're center.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Sorry if I bump you. I'm trying to use every inch of this space. Good. Good, good, good. Did we move this one? I think we did. All right. Here we go. Quick. Bada boom, bada bing. Remember, they're all in the same group. They're all in TTL. There we go. And drop your chin just a little. Lean forward. No, too much. And just lean forward from your waist toward me. Yeah, there you go. Nice, nice, beautiful. Good. Boom. Come on. It's like watching paint dry. Come on, come on, come on, come on. All right. There's shadows, but there's far more detail. The shadows are softer because the light source is so large and it wraps around, right? Really nice quality of light. So you can see the larger the light source, the more diffused it is, and the better if you're worried about any type of lines or character, right? Thank you. So let me recap really quick and we'll wrap this up. Your homework assignment is, you got it. Go home and practice. Get that flash out of the hot shoe, off camera, even if you're just bouncing it off the ceiling. I mean, heck, you could pick up a shoot-through umbrella, really inexpensive. I suggest the Halo is a great modifier to start with because it's so versatile and forgiving. The normal size Halo, not this big, the big one. It's very versatile.
More so than a regular shoot-through?
Yes, far more so than a regular shoot-through. The reason being, and it works great with strobes, continuous light, anything, but it's amazingly well for speed lights because of the enclosure and the silver material. So anytime you use a shoot-through umbrella, light reflects off of it. You lose a certain amount of energy because it just does. It bounces off and you lose it. This is enclosed, so it's going to harness as much of that light as possible and still utilize it. And you still have the ability to face the flash at either forward or backwards.
Is that less common?
It is. And you could even make this look like a hard light, such as the softbox, because if we're doing this way, we have 180 degrees of diffusion. But if I want to make it look more dimensional like a softbox, I've lit people with just this edge, and it starts looking really nice, because this is almost a natural fill, and more direction, especially for more masculine lighting. So it's really versatile. It's really versatile and beautiful quality of light.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.